Klanderud from Aspen, Colorado.
Thank you for having me here today. This accomplishes one of the things we had in mind when we passed the Canary Initiative. One was, it was what we needed to do in order to meet the challenge of global warming, both in our own community and across the globe. And secondly, because of the attention that Aspen often gets, often not the most positive, but we are noticed, that perhaps by doing what we were doing, we would catch people's attention that maybe this is something they should do. So I am pleased to be here today and to share with you what we in Aspen, Colorado have done. Aspen's a small mountain town, an international world-class ski and cultural resort, altitude 7,920 feet, a population of 6,500 people that swells to 35,000 during peak seasons. And it is the county seat of Pitkin County, in which 90% of the land is public land. So we live in an enviable environment, but we also have a long and rich history of environmental protection, I think because the very area inspires its citizens to have that. In 2004, there were a number of environmental programs in place that had been in place for many years, certainly going back to the mid-70s. But in 2004, the Aspen City Council made a commitment to achieve the highest level of protection for its environment and its quality of life. So we directed our city staff to come forward with some sort of new initiative or aggressive environmental program. The city attorney, hearing one of the country's more conservative radio talk hosts lambasting the idea that there was such a thing as global warming, immediately had the impulse to challenge it but said, wait a minute, I don't really know that much about it. Did his research and came forward with the Canary Initiative. Aspen's history is as a mining community, and as you all probably know, over 100 years ago, the miners put a canary in the coal mines to make certain that it was safe for human habitation, or at least going into the mines, and if the canary died, the mine was toxic. So it seemed an appropriate name for this initiative. It identified Aspen and other mountain communities as the canary in the coal mine. Part of his research was to bring forth data for the past 50 years collected at the city water plant and compiled by the City of Aspen Environmental Health Director. That information or that data indicated longer summers, shorter winters, and a downward trend in annual below zero temperature days. Now, the data did not cover either a sufficient time period to make reliable conclusions about climate or precipitation trends, nor did we know what effect the continuing trend in global warming would have in Aspen. However, it was our position then, and it continues to be our position, that it's better to know now what those effects might be rather than later, too late. In March 2005, the Aspen City Council adopted the Canary Initiative and authorized the budget to achieve its goals. Let me just give you some background here in light of what's been said about mayors who have executive power and those who really serve as, although a leader in the community, as a member of City Council. We weren't certain. I mean, this is late 2004. Initiative that's taken place across the country to fight global warming and the more recent scientific information that has come out, that wasn't the case even as recently as 2004. Now, it may have been for some of you who have been studying this for years, but for the average citizen and for the average policymaker, it was not as obvious as perhaps it should have been. So I met with the city attorney, and he said, how are we going to move this forward? He first asked me, do you think this is a good idea? I said, I think it's a great idea. We contacted some other leaders in organizations who are interested in this sort of issue. The Aspen Global Change Institute, the Aspen Institute, the Aspen Skiing Company, the Community Office for Resource Efficiency, and the Rocky Mountain Climate Organization. They all thought it was a good idea. They bought into it. And with that, we took it to the city council. So maybe I cheated a little and stepped outside my bounds, but I don't regret it one bit. At any rate, the city council passed this. We hired a global warming manager, and two components of the Canary Initiative were to do an inventory of our greenhouse gas emissions and to do a climate impact statement. That assessment represents a vital component of the Canary Initiative, and it provides a scientific basis for assumptions about our future climate. And in conjunction with the greenhouse gas, greenhouse emission inventory, provides a guide to implement actions to reduce Aspen's greenhouse gas emissions. That impacts assessment, done under the auspices of the Aspen Global Change Institute and with the cooperation of NREL in Boulder, was released in July 2006. Among its findings, scientists had already observed, and this actually is the confirmation of what we suspected with our own data before. Scientists had already observed measurable effects of global warming. Over the past 25 years, average temperature increased 3 degrees Fahrenheit, frost-free days increased by about 20 per year, while overall precipitation decreased by 6 to 17%, depending upon elevation, and the amount of precipitation falling as snow decreased by 16%. Using the 2000 Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report, state-of-the-art climate models, and data specific to the Aspen area, the report was able to make climate projections and illustrate the possible consequences of temperature change through the end of the century. The projections use three different climate scenarios. Under the low or optimistic emission scenario, in which global greenhouse gas emissions peak around 500 parts per million, Aspen is projected to experience about 6 degrees Fahrenheit of additional warming by 2100, giving it a climate similar to that of Los Alamos, New Mexico. Under the high scenario, in which global emissions would continue their rapid business-as-usual increase to around 700 particles per million, Aspen is projected to warm 14 degrees Fahrenheit by the end of this century, giving it a climate similar to that of Amarillo, Texas. Obviously, neither of these scenarios bodes well for a ski resort. The mayor's conferences that have been held, where I had the pleasure of meeting both mayors who are here today, and where the ideas that were shared among communities of all sizes has really been a shot in the arm for moving climate protection programs forward in municipalities. I mean, I see this as truly a grassroots approach. It's the mayors who have the most direct contact with all the people, and that we can move things forward both in our own communities and hopefully as it gains momentum. And 450 signatories already to the mayor's climate protection agreement is certainly going in that direction. We can make a difference. Aspen has six sister cities. And it's and in addition to that, we have a number of other international visitors. The question is asked by them, why hasn't the United States signed the Kyoto Protocol? I can't answer that question, obviously, but we can, at our local level, move the initiative forward in this country. In addition to signing the Mayor's Climate Protection Agreement, previously I had signed the U.S. Mayor's Statement on Global Warming. And in 2004, I also signed the Declaration of Energy Independence, a declaration signed by cities and native tribes to promote renewable energy and the development of wind turbines on Indian reservations. This is particularly occurring. There's an organization called Native Energy. They would like to build wind turbines on the reservations in the Dakotas, and if you're familiar with that area, unfortunately the United States government did not give the native tribes the best land in this country when they remove them from their homelands. Rather than casinos, it seems to me that wind turbines on Indian reservations, particularly in those areas where the wind is about as powerful as you're going to get in this country, is not only an issue of environmental importance, but is also an issue of social justice. I'm going to highlight a few of the things that I think most of our communities are doing many of the same things. Our electric utility, and Aspen does have an electric utility and a water utility. The water utility serves a very broad area, goes beyond the city limits and into the Roaring Fork Valley, or into Pitkin County to a certain extent. The electric utility only serves the original town grid of Aspen. The majority of Aspen electricity comes from Holy Cross Energy, which is continuing to increase its renewable portfolio. But in 2005, over 50% of Aspen's electricity was produced from renewable resources. Today, that's 75%. And we have one of the lowest electric rates in the state. In 1981, Aspen and Pitkin County were successful in the development of hydropower resources at Rudai Reservoir in Pitkin County. In addition to its hydropower production, Rudai was and continues to be a significant recreational and environmental resource for the Roaring Fork Valley. Today, there are two hydropower resources to supply electricity to Aspen. A third is in development, and an analysis of a fourth resource outside Pitkin County is ongoing. Another irony, until 1968, the Aspen Electric Utility received its electricity from a hydropower facility. The mayor and city council in 1968, which is not that long ago, determined that it would switch to the grid. So we're now going backwards and coming back to where we were and going beyond. The utilities department has launched a demand-side management program. It encourages and provides financial assistance for appliance rebates, renewable energy systems, and energy audits. And beginning in late 2006, the department delivered and continues to deliver a mix of CFLs to city electric customers at no cost. In 2005, the city council requested that staff memos on requests and land use applications to council include a section to address environmental impacts, including projected GHS emission increases or reductions. But we have a program called the Renewable Energy Mitigation Program, and that was adopted by the City of Aspen and Pitkin County in 2000. It was the first of its kind and has national recognition. In fact, it is one of the finalists in the Harvard University's Ash Institute awards program this year. Two of our people will be going to Washington, D.C. Next week or the following week for the final interviews. It's a $100,000 award if you win first place in that, and we're hoping. RAMP was designed, as the acronym is, to promote renewable energy and energy efficiency and help create a clean energy future. Requiring applicants for new homes to either mitigate high energy use on site or pay a fee, impacts are neutralized. The RAMP program has raised over $6 million in 6 years, and those funds are available for energy efficient and energy alternative upgrades in existing buildings or energy efficient or energy alternatives in new development. Within the past 2 months, the City Council adopted greenhouse gas emissions community reduction goals, 30% below 2004 levels by 2020 and 80% below 2004 levels by 2050. In 2005, we joined the Chicago Climate Exchange. And there are questions, I know, you know, as we're moving into the next phase of all of this, new questions arise. There are questions about offset programs. Some people think they don't do anything. another thing that I like to let people know is that if you're going to purchase offsets, examine carefully from whom you're buying them and what those funds go to purchase. It's extremely important that if you're going to purchase offsets, that they are the most effective that you can purchase. Having given you all the good news, the greenhouse gas emissions inventory that was completed in 2004 determined that Aspen's greenhouse gas emissions in 2004 were 840,875 tons of CO2. The typical Aspen household generated approximately 52,540 pounds of CO2. One of the things we did that a lot of places don't do is they measured air travel from your original destination. So if you're flying from Paris to Aspen, all of that got counted. That's a little excessive, I think, but we're in an odd position. We're a resort community. If you look at this, we have tremendous amount of air traffic, both commercial and general aviation. It's a dilemma we all face. If we're going to solve this challenge, as it's been proposed to us, and having the information that we have, there are some significant lifestyle changes that may need to be made. And I think each of us has to ask ourselves, how far are we willing to go? And that we who are in policy positions need to ask ourselves, what are we going to demand of our citizens, and in the case of a resort community, our visitors? And I think we have to be realistic, because I think changes need to be made. But if we're purists in this situation, we're going to drive people away, and they're not going to do it. The most difficult thing to change anywhere is human behavior. And how you educate people and assist them in doing what they may need to do so that we do preserve what we have for our children and grandchildren may take a delicate hand. It's a little bit like going on a weight reduction diet. Be gentle with yourself. Know what your goal is. Even if you have to take one step at a time, I think that's fine. Don't be too critical. And I think if we all work together, we can make some significant differences. Thank you again.